Thanks for having me.
It's always a pleasure to come back to Newcastle. I've got a bunch of you, as you probably know, up in Sydney visiting me. I have a sort of fascination and obsession with the idea of borders and boundaries and the way in which we make them. And so I'm interested in the ways in which we might unmake them. So this is partly something about research that's in my PhD. It's also partly something about a lot of the content of the teaching I do. It's also partly my reaction to current and ongoing political scenarios. So, and it's also about the city, right? And I think we need to start with the beginning of the city. Of course, the city begins with a crime. This is the murder of Abel by his brother Cain. Cain went on to found the first city in history. And of course, you know the story. Cain was a farmer and Abel was a nomad. And so throughout history, there's been this presumed conflict between the settlement and the nomadic desire to move across the landscape. But the thing I could never really understand in all the paintings, of course, done many years later, in all the paintings of this act, Cain, the settled person, is always shown swarthy. He's always dark-skinned. Whereas Abel, the nomad, the goat herder, is pale. And this is consistent across every painting that you see. And couldn't really figure it until, you know, I did a little bit of research into this is the first farm that archaeologists found, you know, from 8,000 years ago. And so if you're a farmer, you're working here. You're working outside in the sun. It's probably not fun at all, right? If you're a goat herder, your goats do all the work. You sit under a tree in the shade. And so the trespass in this instance, which led to the killing of Abel, was by one of Abel's goats, who simply following his desire, this line of migration across the earth, in pursuit of a cabbage or whatever was growing, simply crossed an invisible boundary that Cain assumed was his. And so Abel was killed over an act of trespassing, and trespassing by a goat, which seems a bit futile. But I'll give you a little bit of personal history about this idea about the difference between borders, which introduces this idea which I think is complicit with our making of any border, which is one of color. This is the border between Haiti and the Dominican Republic, and they occupy an island called Hispaniola. Haiti was settled by the French, who promptly eliminated all the natives and brought in black African slaves to run sugar plantations. The Dominica side was settled by the Spanish, who did what the Spanish did, which was basically procreate with the locals. Haiti side is completely overpopulated and completely denuded. In the 1930s, Haiti had a dictator, Trujillo, who was concerned about the incursions of the dark-skinned Haitians across the border into the Dominican Republic. And it led to a number of terrible massacres by the Dominican army. At around that time, my grandparents on my mother's side, who had migrated from the Soviet Union, they were white Russians. They had to flee the revolution. They ended up in Belgium, where they had their family. And then World War II started, and part of the Hitler-Stalin pact was that any white Russians that Hitler captured moving west, he would send back to Stalin. So white Russians became kind of persona non grata around the world. Trujillo, though, had a white Dominica policy. He wanted to encourage white settlers. He would give them land on the border, fearing that someone would protect their land more vehemently and violently than an army ever would. And then he heard about these people, white Russians. So he thought, that's perfect. So he sent messages to all the embassies around the world that white Russians were welcome. So my grandparents and their children ended up here, and this was the original Banana Republic. You know, bananas was a dominant thing. So that's my kind of personal involvement in the border that leads to these kind of distinctions which lead to a lot of things shifting. But if we want to talk about the city, we also want to talk about architecture. So the very first architect, Daedalus, got his start. He was also a migrant, by the way. He ended up in Athens by chance. He was singled out because he was so good at his craft. His first craft was building these statues, Daedalon, which were presumed to be so lifelike that they had to be chained into place lest they run away. Now, for Daedalus' supporters, this was considered an enormous compliment, you know, the veracity of these statues that would move. Years later, Plato and his disciples considered this lifelike attribute, the desire of statues to run away, to be absurd and silly. They valued the fixity of knowledge. For them, the chain was the essential thing, as opposed to what Daedalus saw as the migratory instinct of knowledge. So for Daedalus, being a maker, knowledge was an active thing instead of being fixed in point. Of course, Daedalus later became a forced migrant because he killed his nephew out of professional jealousy, he was banished, and he ended up with King Minos of Crete, where he became his naval architect, the cutting up of shapes to make ships, and his armorer. And one of his most famous acts, of course, was the making of the artificial cow into which the queen secreted herself so she could achieve union with the holy bull. Now, the very interesting thing about that cow, other than the fact itself, is, of course, comes from Daedalus' idea of armor. And his great invention with armor was to leave pieces out so that the warrior could move much more effectively when they were in combat. Armor up till then was fairly rigid. So this leaving out of things in the fabric of making becomes significant in the trajectory of architecture. Of course, with the queen, the leaving out of a gap and aperture becomes singularly important as well. Daedalus, of course, was imprisoned for that and other transgressions, helping Theseus flee from the labyrinth. He was imprisoned in the labyrinth of his own making, so good was it he couldn't get out of it. And of course, he became a trespasser, a migrant again, with his son, unfortunate son Icarus. He had to flee. He had to, in a sense, leave the building. So this kind of, I would suggest, one of the final acts of architecture, we involve ourselves in migrancy, understanding the movement of forces. We involve ourselves in the leaving out of things, but we also involve ourselves in leaving the building. We actually, I would consider it a willful irresponsibility in that we cede responsibility to the people who are actually going to be there. So this final act of architecture of Daedalus is to, in fact, leave, to transgress the boundaries in which he's set. Now, Rome, of course, is a city founded on mythology and boundaries, and of course you know the story of the founding of Rome, Romulus and Remus, the two brothers, suckled by the she-wolf, and they couldn't decide which hill to found the city on. And so Palatine was Romulus, and the Aventine was Remus, And Remus just thought, well, let's just build the city and let the city become what it is. Remus said, no, it needs a place. And so he did this thing, he built a wall to define what Rome is. Remus thought that was fairly absurd, and so went over to visit his brother and leapt across the wall, which was just a couple of stones. And his brother promptly killed him, and then rebuilt the wall much higher, and inscribed on it, and inscribed on the walls of Rome to this day, is this mantra from Romulus: "So perish everyone hereafter who shall leap over my walls." The beginning of this kind of stand your ground law, which in America says if someone crosses your boundary, you can kill them. You know, this is the first instance of that law. So this idea of the elevating of an artificial boundary in denial of a migratory movement, it is the conflict. It doesn't have to do with nomadism versus settlement, it has to do with an artificiality of the boundary versus an innate or organic or natural idea of movement across a landscape. So of course, Rome becomes famous as a city so well defined that its clarity in our head is unparalleled. Everyone knows this drawing, which this is a fragment of. It's the Noli plan by Giambattista Noli, who was a Roman surveyor, a child of the Enlightenment, and he used all of the scientific instruments of the day to construct what was then considered the perfect map of Rome, 12 plates showing every public space, every square, every plaza, But I would consider it the most diabolical drawing in the history of architecture, because it invents this thing called the figure ground, in which the white is visible and the black is invisible. It's the beginning of real estate agency, which says, I know what's beyond that boundary, and I'm going to value it, and you're going to have to believe me, because you can't see what's beyond that boundary. It reduces the idea of the domestic to the private, and the public to the visible. And this divide between public and private, this elevation of the boundary to a territorial distinction, is at the heart of, I would suggest, the housing crisis in Australia today. And also the kind of crisis of confidence in our cities in order to manage the public. Orhan Pamuk, the great Turkish writer, was going to become an architect. He went to architecture school. And he graduated from architecture school and he moved to Istanbul. And he went looking for a flat in Istanbul. He went to this particular Istanbul that has these great large mansions that had fallen into decay and over time been colonized and turned into a number of small flats. And he kept going into these amazing buildings and finding this wealth of stories in them, different families. And there's an old lady cooking soup, there's a young couple making love, there's kids playing with their toy trains, versus the image of the mansion on the outside. And he realized that if he became an architect, his work would be confined to the figure on the outside, the picture of that boundary. He was much more interested in the things that happened inside. He saw architecture in its fascination with the making of walls as an impediment to the telling of stories. So he abandoned his desire to become an architect, became a novelist. I think we're fortunate because of that. And went on to tell stories instead of making barriers about them. So this idea of making these artificial barriers is most evocatively kind of told in the making of national borders. And this is the border, of course, between Mexico and the US. And I challenge you to tell me which one is the US, which one is Mexico. If you know which way the sun is setting, you can probably guess. That's Mexico there, that's the US there. But of course, you go 50 meters out in the ocean, and it's a moot point. There is no barrier between the Mexican bit of ocean and the US bit of ocean. So the absurdity of the boundary becomes immensely clear when you see this reified line across a uniform territory. The US, of course, is considering building this 3 miles further out into the ocean, and I suppose then 50 miles out into the ocean, to prevent whales from illegally crossing the border. But this becomes the border on land, right? US is the blank bit, because it's desert, no one really wants to live there. Mexico comes up against it. And this border, because it is so physicalized and so made, becomes an accretionary device. It is one of the highest crime centers in the world, the US-Mexico border, because pushing up against it are things and forces that cannot get through. Drugs, guns, tequila, you name it. And it stops at this line and accrues and becomes immensely kind of this sediment of movement that can't go anywhere. And because it is the most heavily policed border in the world, more policed than the Israeli-Palestinian wall, it's almost impermeable, even though it's completely riddled with tunnels and holes and all of that. But it creates this artificiality that damages the environment on either side of it. Those people who can get through are confronted with a wasteland, a lot of them die. By contrast, this is the border between the US and Canada. So I would say as well that this involves us in this issue of color. And it couldn't be more black and white in that. And I think it's also kind of black and white in the minds of the US. This is the border between the US and Canada. And in a room full of people, could you pick out the American or the Canadian? Probably not, right? And you look at this uniform landscape, and there's simply just a little track. There's no fence, there's no wall, there's nothing. Lots of people cross it all the time. It's the longest unpoliced border in the world. And I would suggest that it has to do with the fact that it's all the same color. It's all the same thing. So if you were a terrorist, not suggesting that anyone should be, but you would fly to Edmonton and then hire a jeep and just walk across this border. rather than, you know, butt your head up against a heavily policed wall on the other side. So the border center here is just drawn, it's not made. But of course, national borders also have a physical presence. And we've all been through these spaces, these kind of immensely compressed spaces of immigration. You know, the airport arrival hall is grand, the departure hall is grand, even the baggage hall is kind of grand, but this place where you go through and you get checked and approved is incredibly condensed, right? It's a threshold space. But I think that has an interest, right? That this idea of the threshold that you pass through, you can become different than what you were before because you're in a different place. But nevertheless, they become this kind of thing, you know, with a full body scanner, that the border wants to be physical. It wants to scrutinize every single passage through it. And so I've become very interested in then the possibilities of this, and people are constantly playing these games, I'm sure you've seen them, with the TSA full body scanners. And so this woman, for example, the gun that shows up in her backside is actually made by folding the denim and doing things in various ways. And so when she gets searched, there is no gun, there's just this folded fabric. And of course, the weapon is a part ceramic, part plastic gun, which she's carrying on her front. And so people are constantly fooling the TSA because the scanners are not real, they're simply drawings, right? And so here's our opportunity as architects, that the act of drawing, which is what an x-ray is, simply making a drawing, and if you know the language of the instrument, you can manipulate the drawing. And if you Google, you know, TSA punking or TSA faking, there's hundreds of images of people smuggling all kinds of things through full body scanners. And I like this idea because it's using the drawing instrument of the x-ray machine to create a different picture. So drawing, I think, becomes the necessary act if we want to propagate this idea of borders being artificial and possibly being negative. Now the threshold becomes significantly important to us. And you know this thing, right, where you go to the next room to get a pencil or to make a cup of tea, and you go to that room and you walk there and you do something else and then you go back, shit, I forgot what I was going to do. And this happens to everyone. It's genetic, right? It happens to every single person in the human race. You go through a threshold, your brain switches off. I'm interested in evolutionary biology to try and explain these things. And they've tried to explain this, that it's hardwired from our deep history when we first became conscious. The first proto-humans lived in caves. It's nice and warm, it's safe, you've got no enemies, it's protected. If you leave the cave with that same frame of mind, an animal jumps on you and eats you. So there's this defense mechanism that says every time we cross a threshold, we have to forget something so that we start to look around. Because that thing that you always do in the new space is the thing that catches your attention. So we're hardwired to use the threshold as a means of reacquainting ourselves with where we are. It's a highly architectural concept. So the penetration of a boundary isn't simply a hole in the wall, it is an opportunity to reorient ourselves. And so that becomes the architectural device that this act of drawing allows to happen. Gordon Maddox Clark, of course, you know, was famous for his perforations. But for Maddox Clark, it wasn't really the aesthetics of the cutting up of buildings, even though it's quite beautiful. It was the promise of what might lay beyond. And he was an urbanist, he had to work in the city. So that there was constantly this idea of the city not being defined by the walls of buildings or the boundaries and barriers set up, but the possibility of moving through those for something else. So this kind of transitional idea. Of course, Maddox Clark's other great act involved drawing and this thing, understanding that property wasn't simply the physical walls, it was also these legal devices called the boundary. Evinced in the idea of property lots and deeds held in the titles office. And he bought a number of incredibly tiny plots, you know, an inch wide, 90 feet long, in between two buildings. And then divided them up legally, got a lawyer to divide them up, and then sold these. You could buy an inch of Manhattan for $50. Call them fake estates. They're quite real, though, you know. And so this act of faking the legality of something that is real, but using the tools of artifice in order to undermine the fabric by which it's made is an incredibly clever act, and one which involves us in drawing, not as a means of representation, but as a tool, like the people who punk the TSA scanners, as a tool of misrepresentation. And so again, as architects, we don't build buildings, right? We actually simply draw. And so we need to understand the possibilities of drawing as these tools that allow us to, in some way, re-represent reality. So here's a project, and the reason we need to re-represent reality is to challenge it. And so here's a project by a colleague of mine who went to Dartmouth with Peter Garfield. And in the late 2000s, after the economic collapse, he did this project, went around buying up foreclosed homes and having them lifted into the sky by a giant Russian Sikorsky helicopter, dropped out of the sky, and he could photograph the results, make these huge photographs. And the diabolical thing about the project and the pointed political act in which he was playing is that he would buy these houses mostly from sort of poor people, so Hispanic people or black people. And he would hire these people to help him on the project. So, and there's photographs of them with the hard hats and clipboards and looking at things. So hire these people to help him destroy their homes in the pursuit of art. And it's awful, right? It's kind of a terrible thing. But it also points out the distinctions that are made on the basis, I think, in this instance of color, clearly. So I'll just leave you with this. We'll come back to this one, because I think it's amazingly confronting and interesting. But where are we in this kind of act of boundary, in this act of drawing? Well, in 1559, nowhere. And if you weren't already here, if you weren't a native Australian, Australia didn't exist. Even though Europe knew it was there, and it had been talked about, it had been speculated on, it doesn't show up. And at this time, everyone was talking about the Great Southern Land, but no one knew what it was. Except for the people who lived here, of course, they knew very well what it was. But they didn't draw pictures of it. They drew pictures of moving through it. It's a completely different idea of map making. But for Europeans, and this was the era of Noli and the perfect description of the world using scientific instruments, cartography was a way of describing the edge of things. So, but Australia was lucky because it had to be drawn into existence. So here it is half drawn. People would add little bits to the drawing as they discovered bits. And sometimes they faked it. You could see a perfect curve, and you go, no, that's not a real drawing, is it? And so slowly, for Europeans, Australia was drawn into existence. And this one, if you ever get a chance to go to the National Library, the original of this, Matthew Flinders' first drawing of the entire continent, he was the first person to circumnavigate it and draw all of it. It's the most amazing bit of draftsmanship you've ever seen. And again, like the Noli plan, you think it purports to show everything. Every bay, every rocky outcrop, every inlet. But if you look really closely at it, and I had a chance to look really closely at it, it's got gaps. And a very interesting thing is if you read Flinders' journals concurrent with this, he talks about the gaps as places of potential discovery. He likes these things. There might be mangroves, there might have been, you know, raging tide, somewhere he couldn't go, so he couldn't see, and he thought that these might be ways into the continent or back into the continent. And his journals are amazing because they're full of this kind of sensual delight of actually exploring into the hinterland, meeting the natives, getting fresh water, trying new food. It's an amazing journal of kind of sensual delight and discovery that has nothing to do with reifying the line. And if you look even closer, the line is not a line. It's the most amazing, you know, razor-fine kind of hatchwork that actually starts to understand the edge of the continent as a threshold, not as a barrier, but as a space in which you might change, a space in which you might reinvent yourself. We still have this thing, right? We still have this idea of the threshold space, the beach, of course, but also these kind of strange constructions. What are they? Are they architecture? Are they civil engineering? Are they landscape? Are they ocean? So I think intuitively, in a very short period of time, us as interlopers have kind of understood something about the possibilities of the threshold space. We also combat the idea of, you know, the property boundary against this. Because a threshold cat doesn't have a line. You know, if you go to Bondi Beach, you look at a map and there's a line. But if you go to Bondi Beach, where is that line? It doesn't exist. The line is here. You can actually inhabit it. So why do we need to pay so much attention to the trying to make things fuzzy? Well, because of this, right? You know, this is Google Earth view of Rome. It's Noli, right? You can see all the public things. You can see none of the private things. And so Google Earth presumes to show us the picture of place, but the one thing you can't see, of course, are the people who live there. And this is fine for the US military, who likes this same technology that Google developed in their drone technology. And this is a photograph from a real drone strike from 2013. And the report that accompanies it, it's got a number and it's got a date, and it says 3 to 5 civilians reported killed, kind of slippery. 2 to 4 reported injured, 3 missiles fired, 1 house, 1 vehicle destroyed, 3 goats intended to be sacrificed for Eid were also killed. So this kind of invisible god from the sky that makes pictures of the world that don't include people, it allows us to do this. That's what the Noli plan leads to. It leads to a picture of the world that we control. So, and this is, you know, I call this drone urbanism, right? Barangaroo. It's a thing that drops out of nowhere. No one has any say on it. It may as well have been a missile instead of a billionaire's son's casino. You know, it has the same irrelevance to the people on the ground and the same deleterious impact to all of us around it. We'll come back to Barangaroo. So how do we make maps? How do we draw the world that doesn't exclude, that actually is a way in which we can include narrative in it? This is Madeleine de Scudery, made this map to accompany a romantic novel. And it's called The Map of Tenderness, in which emotions are mapped and the human trajectory through them. The situationists, of course, were heavily influenced by this idea of things. Points of contact and the journeys between them. And they were interested not in the city as a figure, as a complete whole, but the experiences that we could have through them. Peter Greenaway is another person I'm heavily influenced by, not necessarily his films, but a lot of his other artworks. This image is one of 82 from his film, A Walk Through Age, which is 82 paintings done by Greenaway. And a narrator is talking about his life and his time spent in this county called H. And you realize as you go through the film that he's dying and he's recounting his life. And what this introduces into map making and storytelling is this idea of time, the time in which we occupy space. Google Earth shows us no time, it's an instant. The Noli plan shows us no time, it's a frozen moment. And so we need to learn, again, this act of drawing. How do we draw out time using the tools that we have? How do we better understand the world and the people who live in it using the tool of drawing as a means of making time? Well, we probably start with the original folk who are here, who understand a lot about time, right? They don't measure it and mark it, they simply live it, right? But here's the beginning of architecture. I would say this is before Cain and Abel making that city and having that stash. This is a primal act of city making, right? People around a resource sharing things. They're sharing the benefits of that resource, heat, food. They are also exchanging. They're exchanging stories, they might be exchanging knowledge, they might be exchanging lore, they might be contesting territory. But they do it in this space. So this, I think, is what we miss when we look at the Earth from Google, when we look at the Earth through the drone camera, when we look at the Earth through the figure ground. We miss the fundamental act of us being on the Earth, which is sharing space with someone else. So we go back to Noli, right? And Noli was lauded for this plan. Everyone thought it was perfect. Now Rome knew what it was. So good was the Noli plan that it was used by the city of Rome until 1973 as their major planning instrument, which probably says more about Rome than it does about the plan itself. But nevertheless, that's the degree of veracity that the plan was given. Now, interestingly, here's a way out using those same techniques of drawing. Piranesi. Piranesi worked on the Noli plan. He was, in a sense, his cat monkey. He's a beautiful draftsman. So he helped etch those plates. 14 years later, he made his own version of it. 12 plates, same etching style, called the same thing, Plan of Rome. But it shows everything. And in fact, it shows things that don't exist. It shows the gates of hell. Shows the baths of Jupiter, where Jupiter would come every week and have a bath. It shows strange temples that never coexisted in time, co-located on the plan. And it shows the inside of everything, and everything in it has a story. A story based in time, a story based in fable, a story based in mythology. For Piranesi, Rome was a mythological city. And if you look at the calendar of Rome today, May 25th has a date. And it's the date of the founding of Rome, which dates to 725 BC. And this is the date, according to Rome, in which the she-wolf abandoned Romulus and Remus. So this mythical act is actually considered to be the veritable founding of Rome. Piranesi understood, as did, he was heavily influenced by the philosopher Vico, who railed against the Enlightenment. He thought the Enlightenment was rationality descending on the earth. Piranesi took this on board and really was influenced by this idea of Vico that said, if we lose mythology as a founding basis, as the means by which we tell our stories on the world, we lose who we are in the world. We become rootless migrants. We become migrants without a story. So for Piranesi, this was his way to reestablish Rome as a city that was real, but also has its foundations in deep mythology. Because if we lose that, we lose what Rome is. So back to Barangaroo, and Barangaroo features as a kind of, not as a site for my PhD research, so much as a kind of target, right? And here's a potted rich history of Barangaroo. When the white colonists came, there were two conical hills that they couldn't really understand, see them on the map. And they mapped them. Perfect conical hills. It was only later when they sort of, you know, negotiated with the locals who lived along this whole bay that they realized that they were oyster mittens. So the local tribe, that's what they collected and they exchanged, and tribes had come from all around, this measure of exchange. So this edge, this threshold was a place of exchange back then. But also interestingly, keep this in mind, it had a fake hill or two that kind of fooled people. Later on, of course, this whole area became the docks for Sydney. Everything in and out of the colony, you know, went through here, Darling Harbour, Cockle Bay. And it's always shown on the back of these drawings of Sydney, seething, smoking. Kind of. And you read the stories of the time, and it was seething and corrupt, and it was full of gambling dens and prostitution and smuggling and, you know, whorehouses and bars, and it was vibrant, right? And the drawings of it are incredibly rich. You can't see where the edge is, except to know that it was a transactional threshold for many, many things. And then, of course, years later, it becomes this. It becomes the Patrick's Container Terminal. Stacking and moving objects of the same size, but of different colors, but of indeterminate value, determined only by the person who's dealing them out, a lot like a kind of poker table sort of thing, but still a sort of transactional edge for things coming and going from around the world. So then we're left with this, right? Gambling, prostitution, international exchange, back and forth, corruption, maybe a fake hill. So maybe Barangaroo hasn't changed. Maybe it's just become more so. But the problem with this, the problem with, you know, the Son of Packer thing and the Rogers thing and all of that, is that it's just one story. It's this kind of crust of the story, and we miss all of that mythology of what this place would be. So I've got a little project that starts here on Cockatoo, because I'm interested in the harbour as a kind of conceptual place of Sydney. Cockatoo, you know, is kind of, it was a rocky outcrop, then a prison, then a naval dockyard. And it has these markings of barbarity, colonization, industrialization, shipmaking, and then abandonment, which become interesting. So we started doing this project that had to do with migration, you know, because I'm interested in this idea of movement. Ellis Island, there's this great the one shining moment in the history of the US, you know, to do with migration, the stopping point for 12 million people who migrated to the US, 99% of whom were accepted as US citizens between 1890 and 1920. Imagine it happening today. Those people went on to be the ancestors of 65% of Americans today. This act of migration as a productive force became something that was interesting and kind of influenced our ideas about cockatoo, but also this idea of an embedment of a deep mythology, you know, that if we're going to bring things there as we do as colonizers, perhaps we can bring mythology as well. So the story of Daedalus and Crete and the place of making. And it involved a lot of wandering through the island, not looking at the physical fabric, but kind of trying to excavate stories. I was working with a team of students who were doing independent projects at the time, which sort of fed into my research. And remapping the island in a way to look at the edge and where the edge isn't aligned, but what is that edge? What is it physically? But also looking at how it changes, and you can see the lines, you know, that's it originally, that's it 20 years later. It constantly shifts, right? So territory isn't exact. It can't be defined by this line. And then I did a series of portraits that were excavating place on the island. So this one is the grain silos carved by the convicts with Theseus, kind of murderer, philanderer. And conflating the physical place with this kind of mythological sensibility to see what I could pull out of the island that wasn't physical, but that might be narrative, that might be operative. I did a series of these portraits. This is Pasiphae, the queen who gave birth to the Minotaur. She's conflated, of course, with the dry dock, the place where ships are berthed. And it's a highly fertile, productive sort of relationship. And the students did these investigations based on finding strange incongruities. So I'll give you an example of one little story. A student found two sinks side by side, got fascinated with the idea of two men side by side who couldn't have this relationship because it was 1930s. And she told the story purely in fragments of timesheets and a half-finished letter and things. And so the inspiration then led to this portrait, which is the Minotaur, this man-beast hybrid, the two things that never come together, and the space between the turbine hole, the biggest machine on the island, and the raw rock that was kind of these two things that never reconcile. These kind of observations led to the making of instruments. The students then made these sort of one-to-one instruments on the basis of my briefings. This was called the dark room, in which you looked in one side and you saw the profile of one of these men, and you looked in the other side and you saw the shadow of the other man, but you couldn't see them at the same time. You had to negotiate space, so they could never be brought together. So that led to this little device here, which is a vessel built on the island that leaves the island. In this case, it's a floating cinema in which the two bits are separate. So wherever they want to establish themselves, they can make space. So these become, cockatoo has a history of making instruments that leave the island and attack other places. So these become instruments that are leaving cockatoo. They've got the sites on Barangaroo, to, in a sense, kind of colonize it with the aim of telling these stories about it. A floating theater, a floating pool, little nod to Rancourt House. And we've done a lot of work on cockatoo over the years with a project, Urban Islands, who some of you know. And this is one of the more influential projects. I think Mark Smout and his team became very interested in this space between the hull of a ship and the Fitzroy dock, in which men would work in this kind of oars men. In this kind of strange space between the curvature and the step thing. And of course it doesn't exist anymore because the ships are no longer there, the docks flooded. But they recreated it in Scotch-Brite tape and fishing line as a space out on the tarmac. But the very interesting thing about this is you can't see it. It only shows up under flash photography, which you can only do at night. And of course when you're taking a flash photograph, you can't see the thing because you get blinded. So they made this real physical space of a lost space, but one that you can't see except for the after image. And so for me, it becomes this very interesting way of using drawing to make real things, but for us to also step away, to step out on Daedalus and kind of leave it for interpretation. So one of the projects was this floating stage called Walk on Water. stage that was meant to hover just below the surface of the water, allowing you to colonize an impossible space, the surface of the harbor. My friend Tess De Quincey and I did some experiments with it out at Bundanon, and this is a kind of little mock-up of that idea that has a kind of pontoons that you can flood and tune it just right. She did a performance called Walk on Water. It didn't work quite right, started to tip and you could see the edge. But nevertheless, this kind of idea that these instruments become tools to let us see the inhabitation of impossible places differently. They also become weapons in a way, not in the kind of aggressive sense, but they challenge physical reality. So we're working on this for further now, for Schiffer, to see if we can turn it into a real thing. So there's a couple ideas of instruments that are leaving Cockatoo. That's what I'm working on now, these kind of machines that all have these rods, but also because they inhabit the water, you can be underwater. So they have a kind of dual purpose. So the little barge that comes to collect compost and has a fig tree growing on the back and the flying foxes get attracted to it also has arms underneath that will plant mangroves around that rocky headland. And mangroves are beautiful because they blur the edge and they become a kind of ecosystem of the edge. And I'll do it for real, right? I'll go with little mangroves and plant them in the rocks in that beautiful landscape of cut sandstone. And I encourage all of you to go when you go to Brangaroo, bring seeds and just plant them around there. Let's make it a little bit, you know, kind of something unexpected. So go back to this, you know, why do we need to do this, right? This is Peter Garfer's project. And of course, you're thinking, fuck, that's really horrible, he's awful. And it sounds awful, right? But it's a fiction. He invented it. He told the story, his catalogue, 20-page catalogue, which sat on a plinth in the gallery when he showed the photographs for the first time, has an interview with an Italian journalist in which he talks about Peter, the white Ivy League educated guy, hiring black and brown people to do this. It sits on a plinth in the middle of the gallery with these amazing photographs. And it's a fiction, it's an invention. And the reporter from the New York Times who went to review the show read this and became very agitated and looked at the photos and read this again. Never once asked the gallery attendant, is this a fiction? She was under strict instructions to say, yes, of course, who would do this? He didn't ask the question. And he went and wrote a scathing review in the New York Times that says, you know, white Ivy League guy, you know, getting poor black and brown people to destroy their houses. The photographs may be beautiful, but at what price? Of course, Peter had the great pleasure of replying, perhaps he could have asked the question. Every newspaper in New York chumped on the New York Times. Times duped again. Peter became famous. And I ask you this question, and I can't really answer, but where is the boundary of this work? Where does this work exist in the making of the photographs? And they do make them. They build big models this big, throw them up in the air, photograph them, which is an achievement in itself. But is it in the putting of this in the gallery and the making of this fictional story that makes the making of the art more horrible? Or is it in the fact that you need a gullible audience like us to wander in? Because when I first saw the photographs and read this thing, I thought, hey, did you really do this? I believed it. I believed that this was possible for people to do this, for nice people to do this thing. Or is it needing the journalist to buy it and propagate it? I would suggest that the boundary of the work is all of these things, which makes it incredibly fuzzy and no less powerful. And here's a project that I just did in Melbourne a little while ago. I was invited to do a workshop for the Student Architecture Congress on migration. And most of the workshops were cool architects in the cool offices doing design charrettes on pop-up housing for migrants or something. I thought, that doesn't really solve anything, does it? That's so clear and that's so crystalline about what our role is. My spiritual home isn't a cool design office in Melbourne, but it's Section 8, you know, this container bar. And my friends there were happy to help me with this project in which the students who showed up for the workshop, we took away their identity. We had all them put all their things in a plastic bag. We took a Polaroid of them, put it in the bag, wrote a number on it, wrote a number on the hand, gave them white overalls, and put them in a detention center in the corner and left them alone. We did things like have drinks, we photographed them, we documented the whole thing. We later made two of them wardens. We took them out and said, we need you guys to do something. We need you guys to ask questions of your fellow detainees. We can't do it because they're not gonna trust us. We had a couple of the bouncers from Section 8 dressed in camo, so I didn't even have to talk to these people. I could send emissaries. Those two people are talking. Can you get one of the detainees to put a mask on that person? He would go and tell them. They would do it. No one in the bar was operating, no one in the bar came up and said, what are you doing? We sent these two people back to interrogate their peers, but we gave them these suits, so they had authority. They did it. They came back with the answers. You know, we had them interview everyone twice, so we had different answers. We gave these two people, nice architecture students, two black pillowcases and two zip ties, and said, some people were disturbing things. You know what to do. They promptly went back and bagged and tied their peers. This is the world we live in which a black pillowcase and a black zip tie means bag and tie someone up. These are the rules that we make. These are the boundaries that we make. It gets worse. We go on about this project for hours. You know, we pulled someone out who was a detainee, asked him about his questions, which diverged. And at one point he mentioned Stockholm Syndrome. I said, so how are you feeling? He said, well, I'm nervous but excited. What are you excited about? He said, I want to join you guys. I want to wear a suit. We happen to have a third suit. Gave it to him. I said, what will you do if we give you a suit? He said, I'll do whatever you want. You can trust me. He doesn't know us. We haven't been nice to him at all. In fact, quite the opposite. We turned the heating off. We gave him one bottle of water to share, to be decided by one person who would get it. This guy at one point asked the bouncer, can I use force? To do what? I don't know. But he wanted to use force. He wanted to hit someone. We sent this guy back in the suit and said, well, the thing is, we can only have two wardens. Here's a pillowcase. Here's a zip tie. You know what to do. He went straight up to this girl and said, I need your suit. Bagged her, tied her up. This is what we do. This is the acts that we... No one told these people what to do. Just said, here's a pillowcase. Here's a zip tie. You know what to do. These are the boundaries that we make. We construct them. They're completely made. And until we address that, until we address our ability to draw these permanent lines in which that's an other and this is ours, until we recognize that that artificial distinction we make between them and us is the single biggest problem we have, not simply as a profession, but as a race, the human race, until we realize that the boundary is a construct that we make, we're not going to get anywhere, right? This is the result. This is the result of drawing that line and saying, you're something else, and you're not. You need to stay there. We need to stay here. And until we actually understand that the making of a line as a boundary, instead of the creation of a threshold, and the threshold is great, we've all got them. Welcome back, right? Everyone's got a threshold in front of their flat, in front of their house. That's a threshold, right? Until we realize that the making of a line as a boundary is the biggest problem we make, we're not going to get anywhere. Thank you.